you don't approve, Andrew?
No, good afternoon. I mean, we are a very generous country in Britain, and we've made this promise to the poorest in the world to stand by the 0.7 of our gross national income being spent on development and being spent in places like Yemen on humanitarian aid. And the cut of 50% in the middle of a pandemic, I think, is absolutely extraordinary, not least because Britain is the country at the United Nations, the member of the Security Council, which leads by example on Yemen and which leads on the discussions there. And of course, as Orla's report makes so clear, there are probably 4 million, mainly children, who, as a result of this cut, will continue the slow, agonizing and obscene process of starving to death. I think it's a terrible mistake. And also, every single member of the House of Commons was elected just over a year ago on a promise to stand by the 0.7. And that is the law of the land. And any change in that requires a vote. And I'm not at all sure the government could get such a vote through the House of Commons. So it's a terrible day for Britain's leadership on international development that we should cut aid to what is the poorest country in the Middle East in the middle of a pandemic.
Yes, but the pandemic I was going to mention, because that has constrained us as well. And it means that we have far less taxpayer cash than we did.
Yes, that is exactly right. But that is the way the 0.7 operates. The 0.7 is a percentage. It's a small percentage, but it is a percentage of our gross national income. Our gross national income has gone down very substantially this year. And so aid spending anyway goes down by 2.9 billion. And we all completely accept that. That is the nature of our support. We're a generous country, but we take account first and foremost of our own constituents and our own citizens. So it's already going down by 2.9 billion. If the government were successful in persuading Parliament to vote it down from 0.7 to 0.5, that would be another £4 billion. And that would effectively halve the development budget. And that's why we're seeing the 50% cut in humanitarian support for Yemen. And I'm afraid it is a harbinger of terrible cuts to come.
This is the Foreign Office's response. They say the UK remains steadfast in our support to the Yemeni people as one of the biggest donors of life-saving aid. Since the conflict began, we've supported millions with food, clean water and healthcare, and will continue to do so. We're using our UN Security Council seat and working with our allies to push for a lasting resolution to the conflict. And then they say Yemen's leaders must meaningfully engage with the UN. Does that help or answer any of your questions?
Well, it doesn't really stack up, does it? I mean, first of all, we are complicit in what is happening in Yemen. This is a man-made famine. We are part of the Saudi coalition that is blockading Yemen by land, sea and air. And so we are part of the coalition that has bombed the infrastructure in Yemen back to the Stone Age and has led to outbreaks of cholera as a result. But the famine there is man-made, and Britain, as part of the Saudi coalition, is complicit in that. And it's all very well pointing out the aid spending in the past, which I strongly approve and indeed authorised when I was in government. But then if you cut it back by 50%, you have all the consequences which were set out so clearly in New York yesterday by the Secretary General and by Sir Mark Lowcock, the senior British official. And you know, I'm quoting their words, that this will mean children continue the slow, agonizing and obscene process of starving to death. That is the reality. This is the worst humanitarian crisis in the world. And in the middle of a pandemic, Britain is cutting its support by 50%. It's just not what we do in Britain. This is not us. This is not what our DNA in Britain is about.
Thank you very much, indeed, Andrew Mitchell, former International Development Secretary.